presentation is actually split into two about the bone loss and the soft tissue repair, its comparison, and why we always choose to do remplissage. That is what bipolar procedure, and then we will give you in the end the plus and minus of both. Bankart, I say, is a nice apple to eat, but compared to latter J, they are two different entities. It's like comparing apple to oranges.
Rajkumar sir, your net is quite unstable.
Bankart procedure, and because the net is not in my control, I'm using my
Dr. Rajkumar, what we can do is that we will stop your video and your screen can continue. So this will take up less bandwidth.
Yes.
Like yesterday.
Yes.
Now you can continue.
Okay. So now we can hear properly. Madan?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Much better. Yeah.
So we augment it with the soft tissue and we reconstruct it with whether it is a triple loaded anchor or a single loaded anchor. All those has been discussed. And the whole idea is to restore the biomechanics that are there in the shoulder, especially the inferior hammock reconstruction. That is what we are looking at in a Bankart repair. But what about the latter J that we discussed or wanting to discuss in a bone loss, which is more than 25%? Everybody says that it is a non-anatomical procedure and it is a stabilizing procedure with a bone block. If God had to decide that the shoulder should not dislocate, he would have placed the bone block beforehand in front of the glenoid to make it not to dislocate. So man is trying to recreate a belt and suspender procedure along with the conjoint tendon and the subscapularis to prevent a dislocation and also to increase the surface area of the glenoid. So this is the basic concept of a Bankart and a latter J that we need to know. Now, if we go by the world standards, who are the people who practice these kind of procedures and how much of them really watch for these procedures to, you know, treat a first-time dislocator or a recurrent dislocator? 90% of the people outside France, they do soft tissue Bankart repair. Even in France and in entire Europe, there are only 72% of people who practice a latter J procedure, which they generally vouch for. So with this bias, there could be people choosing to do only a Bankart procedure in certain instances, as the speakers have alluded to, or some people would like to do a Bankart and a remplissage procedure, or it could be only a bony procedure. What about traumatic shoulder dislocation? As many of us were discussing this in the first presentation when Ram was talking about, we see that when a first time dislocator comes to us, there is an 80% incidence that he will have a Bankart lesion. That is for sure. He will definitely have a Hill-Sachs lesion as well. Plus or minus, he can have a bony Bankart lesion or additional injuries of the cuff and biceps injury. This has to be, you know, really spoken to the patient that you see. And then you can ask an MRI straight away if the patient is compatible for your treatment. Surgery in such a scenario would reduce the rate of recurrent dislocation from 73% to 17%. Also, the return of sport increases from being 50% to 93% if you manage surgically when compared to a non-operative procedure, as this literature has alluded to. Now, when we do a surgical procedure, whether it is a first-time dislocator or a recurrent dislocator, are there chances that they re-dislocate? And when a patient asks you in your practice or in your clinic, sir, when you repair my shoulder, is there a possibility that I can re-dislocate? Yes, there is a possibility. Whether you do a latter J or you do a Bankart repair, there is a possibility that they can re-dislocate. So there is not a foolproof treatment when you try to manage these kind of pathology in your clinic. So where do we stand? This is one of the famous indices that all the shoulder surgeons use in practice called as the instability severity index score, very well written and published by Beg and Bolo. This is one of the classical scoring or the indices that all the instability procedures quote in their literature. But let's dwell for a moment on this indice, which decides how do we go about treating a patient. These indices don't assign any patient for recurrent dislocations. Also, if you can see the degree of participation of a sport here, whether it is competitive or recreation. And if you look at all the younger individuals, most of the school-going individuals and college athletes will be involved in a competitive sport. Some of them will be more in a combative sports. And in most of them, the scoring rate will be more than 5. And to choose a patient with only a soft tissue procedure in such an indices, such a case would be dubious, or it could be detrimental to their sport that they are practicing. Also, the hyperlax and the scoring by the heel sacs and the scoring of the glenoid by an AP X-ray also is questionable, because the glenoid is best seen in a Bernard's view rather than in a shoulder AP X-ray. So having said that, treatment would be challenging when we treat younger individuals, especially the contact sports athlete, and also if there is more chances of recurrent dislocation that is not documented in an instability severity index score. Having said that, if you have gone through the current paper by Giovanni, he says that there are more number of patients we have overtreated by a lateral jaw procedure by using instability severity index score rather than treating them only by a soft tissue procedure. So this is a point that everybody should note and think about how best we can use this score in our clinical practice. So what would be the indications? Now when we go forward to really choose a patient, what should be our indication to do a soft tissue procedure or a bony procedure? If you're looking at anatomical Bankart repair, there should be a non-critical bone loss, meaning absolutely the bone should be virgin kind of a thing when you see it on an MRI. The instability severity index score should be more than or equal to 6, and he should be a first time dislocator, and he should pray that he comes to you within less than 6 months of injury. There was discussion when is the maximum time that he can have the best outcome of a Bankart surgery, and this is what is written in the literature. Best results are accepted within 6 months of surgery. Beyond that, the quality of the tissue comes down, and with the number of dislocations increasing, the quality of the tissue will go down. So that is a point that you people should keep in mind. A failed Bankart, multiple recurrent dislocations, EZ scores more than 4, and off-track lesions, and with the width of the heel sacs, which is more, they all fall into category of a lateral jaw procedure. Am I clear, Chirag? You are able to hear? Rudra?
Yeah, we are able to clearly hear you. Go ahead.
Thank you.
Very clear.
Now, when this paper was read out to the August gathering on that day, they were really confounded to find that it is equal to the knee ligament injuries where the TJT sets in at the time of dislocation of the knee or a knee ligament injury. Similar is the case in the shoulder. The first time dislocator is already on the pathway of having an arthropathy of the shoulder. Whether you do a Bankart repair, whether you do a remplissage, or whether you do a lateral jaw procedure. So this is a paper that won an award because of the quality of the research that these people did, Hovelius and his group, and they won a NEERS award in the year 2008. So patients should be counseled that if they see some amount of degeneration in the shoulder following the dislocation, this is because of this paper that everybody should get a hand on it and read and quote when they talk to the patients. Now, having said that, there are some risk factors that each individual comes with, and some we can modify, some we don't. The age of the individual, yes, and the sex of the individual, we don't have any control. And if they come with a lesser age group, the possibility that the changes in the bone can be more if we choose certain kind of procedure. And female patients generally are found to be more lax, and in those patients we can find that the results may not be that great when we choose certain kind of a procedure. Bone loss, both Hill-Sachs and Glenard influence your outcome? Yes. How many anchors we should use? What should be the suture material has been discussed. But I would like to say here, minimum is 3 anchors that you need to use, beyond which everybody can use to choose depending on the pathology they see inside the shoulder. Yes, smoking is an absolute contraindication, I feel, for the outcome of your shoulder surgeries. And if they dislocate the shoulder in a younger age, like in ACL injuries, they are also bound to have a contralateral shoulder dislocation, which they should be mindful of. And you should always examine the contralateral shoulder as well for any kind of subluxation or instability when they come to you with a traumatic injury or a recurrent dislocation of the shoulder. And this is the point of contention here. Bankart repair for a first-time dislocator, a 10-year follow-up, whether we need to do an operative procedure or a non-operative procedure. Both procedures have their flaws. And in both the procedures, there is a possibility that they can re-dislocate after, you know, being managed in a fashion that they are described in both these papers. So the bony Bankart repair, only by anatomical reconstruction of the Bankart was done in recreational athletes and laborers. And it was a very long-term follow-up, if you can see in this paper that they have quoted. And they found that still, in spite of doing the best for these kind of recreational athletes and laborers who are found to be heavy manual laborers, the recurrent dislocation rate was around 11%, which is quite high. And only up to 77% of the patients after doing a Bankart repair were able to return to sport. But still, what happened to the 23% of the patients? What happened to them? Whether they were able to return to sport, whether they were able to return to do their activities of daily living normally, it is questionable. But still, the authors go on to say that, yes, their excellent outcome was there on a long-term basis in these kind of individuals. So yes, when you read a paper, you need to read the limitations they have and the limitations of the patients that they are not quoted in the literature should be read by looking at the small print or read between the lines to know what exactly is the full outcome of those papers that you read and practice. So we went on to describe our procedure. This is what Chirag wanted to know, why we decided to do these kind of procedures over a period of time. You know, Hemant and me worked with our mentor and teacher in France, Jean Cani. And the concept at that point of time was the shoulder will not dislocate unless the soft tissue at the back of the shoulders will leave or you have a plastic deformation. That is the reason we always watch for, you know, tightening up the structures both in the front as well as the back of the shoulder so that the ball stays on the T of the glenoid. So glenoid we consider as the T and the ball is the head of the humerus. We always want it to stay at the center of the head when the repair is finished. So whether it is a glenoid bone loss, which is more than 3, which is the only contraindication that we see in our cases. Otherwise, in all cases, whether we like it or not, we dish out only one treatment, that is Bankart repair and remplissage. Now going forward, I'll tell you salient points of how we do a procedure and why. We have been taught, you know, not to use much of a shaver on the Hill-Sachs side. The reason being there is already because of number of dislocations the person has or the lady has, there will be certain bone loss. Same is on the glenoid side. We just use the rasp or the needle to just clean off whatever fibrous tissue is there on the Hill-Sachs lesion and freshen it up to make a bony bed for the infraspinatus to heal onto the Hill-Sachs defect. Initially, we used to use double-loaded metal anchors, and now of late, we have been using, you know, bioabsorbable anchors to make it comfortable for the patient. We sometimes use 2 double-loaded anchors, or of late, as authors have been describing, even 3 or 4 anchors into the Hill-Sachs, as Sugaya and my own colleagues have been using. It is up to your choice, but if you are comfortable, 2 is the minimum that you need to use, which is a double loaded anchor, which is shown in the picture in this fashion. They should be put at an angle of 90 degrees between both. You can see these, the weaving portal is the posterior weaving portal. The anchor that we use, the first one is the most vertical one in the mid-lateral portal. And this is the one which is close to the supraspinatus behind. Between these two, we should have a 90-degree angle. The reason being is when you put the anchors in this fashion, there is a 9 out of 10 possibility that when you make a bridge suture out of these anchors, they are likely to catch the tendon of the infraspinatus rather than the muscle of the infraspinatus. If you catch the muscle of the infraspinatus, then there is a likely possibility that you will tear and the outcome of this procedure may not be great. So sometimes people are wanting to ask you, how sure are you that your sutures or the knot will come onto the infraspinatus? So you need to sometimes go subdeltoid into the subacromial space, clear of the bursa, and try to get both the sutures out in the same entry portal, as you can see here in this fashion, so that you can, you know, really tie the buttress suture onto the infraspinatus in a sliding manner. If you can see, we pull the sutures after tying the knot in this fashion, and the knot, as you pull onto the tails of the suture, we can see that the bridge is going inside the shoulder and it will come onto the infraspinatus in this fashion. So we can have a nice bridge across the infraspinatus that is going to go and sit onto the hill sacs and will give you a nice remplissage effect onto the hill sacs. We generally don't use cannula in this area. Some people do use cannula and take a bite in the capsule, and that involves a little more time consuming procedure. This is a very simple procedure. You put two anchors in a 90 degree fashion as shown, and then you can retrieve the suture subdeltoid and tie this first before doing your Bankart procedure. Because once you do the Bankart, doing a hill sacs will become a difficult task. If you want to be very sure what you have done is right or wrong, you can visualize this from the anterior portal and see that you have not tightened your infraspinatus onto the hill sacs. And once you tighten, you'll see that on the next slide here, that the infraspinatus nicely sits onto the hill sacs. So use at least three sutures on your Bankart and do a remplissage in this fashion. I am sure your results will be phenomenal and there won't be any limitation of activities. Very few people, when you don't, you know, get the sutures onto the tendon, will have some limitation of activities. But yes, antiflexion, external rotation and internal rotation will be phenomenal and they will get back to near normal function in a very fantastic manner. This is the next slide that I would like to show you, which will be very surprising. I'll give to you the brief of this this thing. The guy in the yellow t-shirt is my patient, Sanjay, with his right shoulder, with the green arm one, is the one where it is the repaired one. And you know, everybody will know Padu, who is the guy who really, you know, brings back all my patients to the fore or to the level where they want to be. If I have to play this for you. 8, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. I need the comments of the panelists on this at the end of the presentation. The right shoulder of Sanjay was the operated shoulder. And if you can see, at 6 months, he was comfortable in doing what he loved to do. So yes, a remplissage procedure can be, you know, a very confident procedure for you to use in your clinical practice and bring back the patients to a near normal function. So the downside of a lateral jaw procedure that I would like to bring across to all the August faculty here is, it is very difficult to choose it in a first time dislocator or even in the recurrent dislocators when you choose in a young patient. The reason being, if you follow the Wolf's law, the coracoid that we put it at front of the glenoid goes for increased remodeling. There will be more osteolysis. There will be prominence of the screws that we use and which will be the cause of pain and arthropathy. If we err at least 1 millimeter lateral or 4 millimeter medial in placing your coracoid graft onto the glenoid, where the margin of error is very small, there will be lysis of the graft. Having said that, there are different mechanics of fixation of this bony bankart, this coracoid process onto the glenoid. Some have described endobutton, like Pascal Bolo and his team. Some have described using a soft tissue stabilization of the bony bankart in front, like using of the biceps tendon. Some use a split in the subscapularis. Some don't use a split in the subscapularis. There is a choice of the surgeons. But having said that, the function, whether you do in whichever way, there will be some loss of internal rotation as well as external rotation. And to surmount that kind of a procedure, which is technically a little challenging for the beginners to do arthroscopically, even if you do by open procedure, the chances of fracture, nerve injury, non-union, malunion, implant failure, and poor revision rates have been recorded in the literature as current as in 2020 American Journal of Sports Medicine. So if we have to revise, we have to look at a graft which is there in the iliac crest. We call it as Eden-Ebinet procedure. Or even if that fails, Proventure has described what is called as using the allograft from the ankle. So being a challenging option for patients who fail lateral J, imagine if all the three procedures fail, what next is the question. So my urge or my request for all viewers and the August panel is try Remplissage, you will not regret, is my gut feeling. And that should be the take-home message of this talk. We also tried our hand at doing arthroscopic lateral J procedure just to make sure and tell you guys that it is possible to put bone screws or bony block procedures by arthroscopic method and without any additional complications that we saw in the previous slide that I had put. But having said that, yes, in long-term follow-up of these kind of patients, there will be some sort of, you know, downside to the procedure that everybody should be mindful of, which is more higher than the soft tissue procedures that we do in a shoulder recurrent dislocation. So I urge all of you to look at how you select your patients while doing a particular procedure. You choose a study wherein there are adequate number of cases that have been followed up to, you know, guide you in the way you treat the patients. There should be long-term studies, you need not use a short-term study to, you know, guide you in what they have to say to you. And always, as Chirag has rightly put it, you have to train your radiologist or send them to a radiologist who has sound knowledge of how to give you the input on the glenoid and the Hill-Sack defects, the on-track and the off-track lesions, which will help you in managing your patients. And yes, not only training yourself, you need to train your personnel also to help you how to do the procedure in an optimum way. And I thank the team for having given me this opportunity. Yes, an appropriate apple a day keeps a dislocation rate at bay. Thank you very much, Chirag and team. Thank you.